Thank you very much, Golda, and I want to say hello to everyone who is on the seminar this morning. Let me tell you, there's a barrier I was born into. There's a barrier that every small islander inherits, especially after colonialism. It is the barrier of self-contempt. You're a little place. You're not metropolitan. You wouldn't send men to the moon. You wouldn't invent the latest greatest computer. And you're not making any destructive weapons so you can kill the next man and take all his property and call it yours. You're a little island. So you're born into a situation where you feel lesser than other people, and it's called self-contempt. But once I began to shed my self-contempt after the power of this thing we call mass was revealed to me, it becomes a mission of mine to help people shed this self-contempt. Because some people still don't understand that the things that we do best are worthy of hallelujahs. I start with the words that aren't mine, but those are the words of the iconic Guyanese Trinidadian massman, Peter Minshall, a god to many. Minshall is undoubtedly one of the Caribbean's greatest creatives for his carnival work, yes, but more for his art direction. This quote is from an interview that he did in 1995, just under 1 year after I became Minister of Culture, 1 year after I entered into the Cabinet of Barbados, which came after he had already directed, by the way, the opening ceremonies of the 1992 Barcelona Olympics and the 1994 FIFA World Cup. He would go on to create the opening ceremonies for the 1996 Atlanta Olympics, the 2002 Salt Lake Winter Olympics, and the 2007 Cricket World Cup, with which I had the honor to work with him personally. Peter Minshall personifies world class. He is in the business, my friends, of the moonshots of which I spoke. While Minshall's artistic license frees him up to use terms such as self-contempt to describe the Caribbean's underdevelopment, my technical sensibilities draw me to the more balanced phrasing of cultural confidence, or more to the point of lack of cultural confidence. From political unrest to gun violence to bleaching of skins, the root of so many of our current regional problems boils down, I believe, to issues of identity and lack of cultural confidence. And that is why in our own covenant of hope, we literally put as the first chapter, identity and confidence. Because without that, we will go nowhere. That's why on my phone, I carried a picture of the great, late, great Robert Nesta Marley to remind me of two phrases: emancipate yourselves from mental slavery, and of course, what does it profit a man to gain the world and to lose his soul? Neither of those statements are original to Bob, but Bob understood the power of amplification with respect to them. He understood what it would do to our identity and to our cultural confidence. He understood that he was speaking each day and every day to that little boy and that little girl going into primary school, going into secondary school. At the end of the day, I ask us, who are we? What makes us? How do we solve our own problems? What is our purpose? What is the value of our contribution? As a region, we had all of this and so much more to consider. And then, boops, comes COVID. But you will forgive me, as an eternal optimist and an unwavering believer in the capacity of Caribbean people, I do not see identity issues as irreversible character flaws, nor do I see COVID-19 as an insurmountable challenge, nor do I believe that cultural values and cultural mores don't change. 50 years ago, we didn't play banjo on a Sunday. What is banjo, you ask? Any kind of music that is not hymns or gospel. But now throughout the region, that has changed. Some will argue change for the worse. Some will argue change for more tolerance. But whatever it is, the point is cultural values and cultural mores change. So rather, I see this simply as part of a process of our development. I see it as part of our growing up, as part of the recognition that as adults, we make choices and there are consequences to choices. And to that extent, our family, Our parents, our extended family, and our community must help nurture us in the choices that we have to make. We have moved, my friends, beyond our tenuous toddler and moody teen years, where we were dependent on others for basic needs, beyond the rebelliousness of young adulthood and the stabilizing middle age period. And now, like many 40 to 60 year olds, we in the Caribbean are in a period of resilience and smart investment to secure our future. For countries, just like with humans, this natural cycle of development, of maturing, and of overcoming difficult periods cannot be successfully achieved without first addressing some hard truths. As I say to my people in Barbados all the time, you can't expect to be an adult without having difficult conversations. That's just life. The hard truth is that the Caribbean exited colonialism without the benefit of a development pact. I've been saying so every day for the last few months. Why? Because the whole Black Lives Matter movement has literally reinforced in us the need to examine who we are and how we have gotten where we are. This truth resonates particularly deeply with me in this year, which marks, within a few days, the 75th anniversary of the United Nations founding on October 24th. Our eldest regional siblings, Jamaica and Trinidad, are only 58 years old. Thus, the rules of engagement were established well before we became sovereign states, and yet they have not been extended to us in full. Still, even without the input and resources that were afforded to many European and Asian states by multilateral bodies, the Caribbean region has done a commendable job in providing for the needs of its people. We're not where we want to be, but we've done a lot to come from where we were in that 1930s moment that literally scarred our landscapes from the north right down to the south. For us in the Caribbean, the hard truth is that in the last 40 years, our dependency has transitioned from one vulnerable sector, agriculture, to another vulnerable sector, as we now know so well, tourism. Though operationally vastly different industries, the macro analysis presents, unfortunately, similar traits: volatile products, highly fluctuating seasonal revenues, global marketplaces that dictate our prices and high susceptibility to hurricanes, and now, as we know, pandemics. But may I also say, the hurricanes really represent only the heart attacks of the climate crisis. We face the chronic NCDs in so many ways, not just in terms of our bodily health, but in terms of the climate crisis, namely the droughts and indeed the sargassum that continue to bedevil those who depend on coastal businesses to make their living. The hard truth, my friends, is that Peter Minchell is right. The Caribbean has not, regrettably, been in the business of moonshots sufficiently. Our region, in an age of rapid and bold digital innovation globally, has been slow to digitize and timid to innovate. Not all, but not in across the scale. It's not a bad place. Indeed, for the most part, it is a very good place for us to live. You and I know that. But without the safety net afforded to other countries, we have been hesitant to strive to be the best or the first in this region. Our governments, our financial institutions, our schools, our churches, and our agencies have been regrettably too hostile to risk and resistant to new actions and new ideas. But why? I ask you why. After all, this is the region that produced George Headley, C.L.R. James, Errol Barrow, Kincaid, Eric Williams, Robert Nesta Marley, Sir Arthur Lewis, Brian Lara, Derek Walcott, Naipaul, Armour Trading, Viv Richards, Shirley Chisholm. I could go on and on. Usain Bolt, the Right Excellence of Gary Sobers, and of course our own Robin Rihanna Fenty. We are a region that has already solved some of the most difficult of the so-called developed world's problems with our universal education. People don't talk about it. Our universal education. Our universal healthcare. People don't talk about it. Our stable political system. People take it for granted. Our freedom of choice and social partnerships, hardly ever mentioned. We are a place of critical creative thinkers. We like to abuse one another and we like to use colorful language. We are revolutionaries in our own way. We are inventors, artists, and pioneers. We have already produced the best and we've already been the first. But why do we resist scale? Why do we not understand that scale is at the heart of transformation? How, as a collective, can we not put our own perspective and flair on this digital revolution? My friends, simply put, how can we pivot? I suspect that you, like most of the Caribbean youth of today, already know the answer. The future of the world, and by extension, our future, the future of the Caribbean, is largely in technology. In 1994, when I became Minister of Education and Youth and Culture, I reflected then that we were in a position where we could literally use technology, not for its own sake, but deeply use it as an embedded engine of every sector of our region. I asked us then to remember that it was a powerful tool, but in so remembering, to remember that it did not alter the essence of who we are, because who we are is determined by our values, and our values determine how we use that tool. True prosperity and transformation, my friends, will not come from Caribbean technologies until we have the cultural confidence that Peter Minchell exhibited when he put stilt walkers at the Barcelona Olympiad. We must have the cultural confidence to develop technologies of our own kind, on a timeline that plays to our strengths and which captures the imagination of our own people. We must become a developer of ideas and technologies that allow us to overcome the everyday disadvantages of being a small island developing state. That will allow us to overcome our small population, our small economy, our vulnerability to natural disasters, and our very difficult history of slavery and colonialism. The late professor, the Right Honorable Owen Arthur, former Prime Minister of Barbados, once asked, in what sense is McDonald's superior to a fish fry at Oystins? Or in what sense is jerk pork in Jamaica inferior to McDonald's? Or Laba and Creek water in Guyana? Why should we yield on the preservation of our cultural icons, that traditional way of life inherent in small states, which is so relaxing and rewarding, and which makes living in a small state such an unforgettable experience, to become just another cultural and social statistics? Those were Owen's words. COVID-19 and its impact on our tourism-dependent economies means the time is now for regional governments to develop and implement disruptive and forward-thinking program concepts, policies, and platforms that fast-track the development of a Caribbean technology economy. At the core of this, my friends, transformation must be the sustainable maximization of our most highly valued assets. You know them, and I know them. Our people, our ideas, our geography, our climate, yes, our climate, and our culture. It is only when we increase our cultural confidence and thus maximize the power of our creative imagination that we will be able to build technologies that unlock our region's true potential. We will begin to see that because we are surrounded on all sides by the sea, SEA, our ocean economy is primed for expansion. We will begin to see that our lack of scale steers us to focus on producing quality rather than quantity, thus enhancing our high-value manufacturing sector and what ought to be a propensity for research and development. We will also see that the constant threat of hurricanes makes us global experts, yes, in the business of climate resilience. My friends, in the immortal words of that great Trinidadian luminary C.L.R. James, I quote, "Nobody knows what the Caribbean population is capable of. Nobody has ever attempted to find out," unquote. I say the duty is ours together to pivot right now to find out what that capable Caribbean person is about and what capacity our region is capable of. And I ask us to do so in the words of Therese just now, that we do so by thinking big and working together, because only then will we have the scale and will we have the capacity to transform what I believe is that special place on Earth. We have been that region that has led the world in humanization. We have been that region that has continued to focus on the centrality of that individual person. We have been that region that has sought more for social justice. We can be that region that explores new possibilities and new realities for the 21st century, for the globe. It's not just about Africa, it's not just about Asia leading the world. The Caribbean has the potential to be that entity and that region that can continue to point the way. I thank you.